Back in 2010, we launched the initiative, and we brought to the Australian BIM sector a number of strategies that we thought were needed to help drive the adoption of not only BIM in terms of design and construction, but also supply chain integration. I think over the 10 years, those strategies have served the industry very well. And have really helped us as an industry drive BIM adoption, not just for those major projects, but also to be able to adopt BIM and transform the industry as a whole. Those strategies that we brought at the time included the concept of constructible Revit modelling. One of the things that people wanted to see was that actually the BIM modelling that was being done by designers could actually be built. And so a lot of that constructability advice that practitioners were looking for, the design practitioners were looking for, was actually built into the template. We also launched a national MEP services template used by both designers and constructors, and that still remains a global first, and as far as I'm aware, no other country has been able to implement a national template for services like we have. We also promoted the concept of design to as-built model workflows, and again, at the time, back in 2010, I remember well that we had a meeting where we had most of the major consultants and a number of the head contractors and specialist trade contractors in a room, and we put this concept up, and most of the majors consultants said, no, we're not doing that because it's got all our IP. I still remember that Andrew Bagnall got up and said, well, hang on, if someone's going to actually use my model to actually go and build something, I'm for all that. And from there, things turned around pretty quickly. So pretty quickly, it became business as usual for the consultants to hand over a model, because you're always better to have the model. No matter what any deficiencies are in the model, you're always better to have the model. Now, that practice has started to grow globally, but it was really here in Australia that we were the first to make that business as usual. We also focused on the design to fabrication workflow. And at the time, back in 2010, what was mostly happening were BIM models were getting translated to CAD models, mainly in the MAP platform. And really, the consultants were still asking us to deliver a Revit as-built model. And that was actually probably one of the key drivers in the first instance as to why the AMCA got involved. In 2011, I think it was, Autodesk acquired MAP and started down the route of looking at how the best way to implement that design to fabrication workflow, and we ended up with, a few years later, the fabrication parts solution, which has been an absolute game changer. In that design to fabrication workflow, there's well in excess of $500,000 worth of development work by BIM MEPIS, company organisations such as the NDMA, and many designers and other practitioners. A2K have probably put in a matching amount of development work, and Autodesk have put in a huge amount of work as well. So the amount of work that's gone in to actually deliver that workflow and fabrication parts has been enormous. The other thing that we really focused on was the development of specifications for content. Nowhere else in the world is there anyone who's writing specifications for content that allows manufacturers to build with confidence content to a standard. That has been an absolute game changer in Australia and has served our industry, our designers, our constructors, and our suppliers incredibly well. We have some of the best suppliers in terms of integrated offerings, such as Fantech, who have upgraded all their platforms to be able to deliver Revit content. And it works for both designers and constructors. Hollyoaks, another example. Colago's another. Victolic's gone a long way on the journey with us in terms of, building content that works both for designers and constructors. These businesses are all building on their Revit platforms. And those companies that are doing it are doing really, really well. So at the time, a lot of those things were new, and I think Vimeo Plaza have been able to demonstrate that the strategies that we bring deliver value, and therefore the majority, not just the super users. In terms of where we are now, back in 2017, we started to do a strategy review. Over the last 12 months, the team has put more work in 12 months than at any other year. Part of that has been because we've needed to review what we need to do to get us to 2025 and to really try and drive digital transformation across the sector. But in reviewing what's going on, sometimes when you come to BIM conferences, you tend to think just about BIM and what's going on in that space. But BIM is just one challenge that we're facing. When you look at all of that, these are all the sorts of things that we're having to think about as a business on a day-to-day basis. These are all real challenges, and they're all things that BIM and digital transformation can play a significant role in addressing. Now, there's about probably 8 or 9 conferences that you could run around all of that. So I'm not going to talk about all of those, but I am going to talk about a couple of key ones. So the first thing to say is that it's worth just talking a little bit about the fourth industrial revolution and digital transformation. The two go hand in hand. And this is a thing was really identified as something different to the third industrial revolution, which was more around computing and the internet and those sorts of things, back in about 2016 by a guy named Schwab. But Klaus Schwab was his name. But what you can see is that there's a lot of things going on there. And the real thing to understand is it's the combination of technology and applications. All of these technologies exist today. Probably the one that doesn't exist is what we really would define as artificial intelligence. And take the I out of it and think about what real intelligence looks like. That's still, the experts say, is another 20 to 30 years away. But each of these technologies are huge enablers. So if you're thinking about mobile phones and those sorts of things, they can't work without the battery technology. Neither can autonomous cars, really. So there's a lot happening. Mostly what we're seeing is machine learning, not AI. So it's the convergence, the confluence, and in our case, it's really about applied technology and how those work together. So there's a few things that you should know about industrial revolutions. I'm sure there'll be a number of other presenters who'll cover this in much better detail than I can. But essentially, in each industrial revolution identifies and we become what the technology is not. So autonomous vehicles in mining is a big thing. And basically what has happened is that the autonomous haul trucks have replaced the FIFO drivers. doesn't actually mean less workers, it means a different type of worker. And what you're seeing here is one of the operation centres, I think it's, I'm not sure if it's Rio Tinto or BHP, I've got a logo in it. Oh, it's Rio Tinto, they have got a logo. But what you see here, mostly what you're seeing is machine learning, optimising the operation of the mining, the mine and the rails and the shipping as a system. What you're seeing is probably four or five people actually looking at a problem that the machine learning can't resolve. So they're bringing the intelligence component and adding that to the machine learning component. The actual number of people working on it, on the system, has not reduced. But what this industrial revolution has done is redefine jobs that are no longer required. The other thing is that industrial revolutions are normally really good for consumers. Normally consumers derive significant benefits. But one of the things that came up in yesterday's conversation about transformation versus disruption was one of the things was that with Ford, he gave transport to everyone, but the only car colour that you could get was black. And sometimes that can be a downside in terms of mass production, and particularly you see it in things like supply chains and things like the types of veggies and how they taste these days. But normally these things are good for consumers. They're normally not that good on the supply side. So it's often very turbulent times for suppliers, and sometimes industries and companies that were built in one industrial revolution can get wiped out by another. There's been a lot of hot discussion in the news about GE. So GE and Westinghouse were both powerhouses of the US through the 20th century, both in significant trouble now. But you also see huge redistributions of wealth. And I think the one on the left is Westinghouse, and you probably know the two on the right. But what people often don't understand to the full extent is just the social upheaval that typically occurs with each industrial revolution. If you want to go and see what this really looks like in today, go and have a look at probably one of the best TED Talks there is, which is by Carol Cadwalladr. She's she's I think from Wales, but Facebook's role in Brexit. And then you'll really start to understand what some of the social upheavals, what the effects can be. So you're competing against people who are using technology better than you. You've probably heard that before, but I'd probably say in our types of industries, there's another thing is it's actually people who are using means and methods better than you. Okay, so the technology is one thing, it's the ability to execute as a project team is what really counts. And what you tend to find as well is that these things creep up on you. And so when there's a really good book on all this called Robotics Upheaval, and what it talks about is holy cow moments. So you see lots of things around you happening, and you think, oh, well, the industry's not moving that quickly, or this isn't going to impact me, or I'll get around to worrying about it. And all of a sudden you find that you've been outplayed. And in my view, the next 5 to 7 years, there's going to be a lot of holy cow moments. And I've just, in this presentation, you'll see the little holy cow moment quite a few places. I'm saying to you, pay attention. So it's also worth looking at other sectors. So people often, particularly those who are using applied technology to do stuff. So one of the things is people often quote Uber or Airbnb. I'm not quite sure how they directly relate to our sector, but these two industries, there's some lessons to be learned. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about mining and global logistics. So BHP, Rio Tinto and Fortescue, probably back about 6 or 7 years ago, were in a fair bit of trouble globally because they had quite high cost structures and they needed to do something because they were starting to lose real market share to international miners. What were they able to achieve? BHP's year on year reducing their cost operating cost base by about $1 billion per year. Not quite sure what that total operating cost is as a total, but that's not a bad effort. Fortescue Metals, which was getting going at the time, reduced their cost of production from $40 down to $13 in 5 years. One of the ways that they're doing that is by implementing autonomous vehicles. And Australia runs, was running, probably still is running, the biggest fleet of truly autonomous vehicles anywhere in the world. But what these companies didn't do was that they agreed on with their key suppliers, particularly around the trucks, Caterpillar, Komatsu, and those sorts of companies, to standardise on requirements. And they're essentially running all of the same systems. Where they're applying their intelligence is how they apply the technology and optimise their machine learning back in Perth. They're also running the largest autonomous vehicles anywhere in the world. These deliver about 23,000 tonnes of coal every few hours to the ports. So in terms of this, they're not competing on standards, they're competing on their implementation. And what they've done collectively has enabled them to really get back to number one in iron ore export costs and done an amazing job. And if you think that's, you think, oh, well, that's okay. The other thing that they're really, the mining sector is really strong on is digital scanning and surveying. And Australia is also running, is at the leading edge in underground haulage, autonomous haulage. And what you see here is that they're actually bringing together the scanning technology of what they've just dug out. And a number of these mines are basically no one inside the mine for 18 hours a day. They're just about to start their first fully autonomous mine in Mambi, I think it is, somewhere in deepest Africa. But one of the things that comes out of that is the ability to export expertise globally as an industry and develop an industry capability. So that's an indication of applied technology at an industry level. The other story that I've got is the logistics sector. And it does speak to both the pain involved in innovation and the importance of matching standardisation with digital technology. So right up to the 1970s, most shipping was, international shipping was what they call break bulk. That means that everything was individually loaded and offloaded onto ships. That basically meant that international logistics just didn't work. And that's why in Australia you saw a lot of manufacturing, because it was cheaper to manufacture here than get it through the wharves. But as early as the early 1950s, containerisation was seen as the way forward. But no one could agree on any standards and the industry couldn't progress. It was only when the US got involved in the Vietnam War that they couldn't actually keep the supplies up to their front line. And the Defence Logistics Agency said, I don't care what you guys are doing, you need to standardise on two sizes of shipping containers, and you've got 3 months to sort it out, and I need it all implemented in about 6 to 9 months. When that happened, they started building container wharfs in Vietnam in just a very short period of time. Pretty simple concept. Trucks come in one way, go out the other way, and loading the containers straight onto these trucks. So you need, sometimes industries need catalysts. The UK has a catalyst in their BIM strategy in that they've got their national estate, and that's certainly helping drive BIM adoption there. And it's probably the thing that's missing in Australia is a mandate from government and key large organisations within the government structures actually driving BIM adoption. But then the problem becomes that you end up with something like this turning up on your front doorstep with 18,000 containers on it. And so the standardisation is one piece, but it's the digitisation of the information that allows that to actually be executed effectively that's key. So they've all agreed on an international standard, which is GS1, and that means that your chiller gets put in a container somewhere in China or Mexico or Europe or the US, and that when that sticker goes on that container, everyone can read that container, everyone knows where it's going, everyone knows what's in the container. Hopefully no one's put any drugs inside anything, and keep it all clean. And everyone from the truck driver, the person who scans the container out of the dock, knows where that's going and what day it's going to arrive. We need a common data environment so that we can follow the design, construction, development, and that needs to be beyond just the project, but as a whole common data environment for our industry. And it's got to go beyond engineering, it's got to go to procurement, and it's got to go to life cycle asset management. So here's the holy cow moment. Again, most of you probably don't realise this, but the world's first fully automated port was just built down the road in at Webb Dock. This is a Warwick story. But basically, any container coming through is off the ship and off the dock within 3 days. So this is completely disrupting the whole eastern seaboard in terms of shipping. And if you go and compare it to most of the other docks running around, it's a completely different beast. And so that's their holy cow moment at the moment. Now, there's been some other docks that are much larger and are now fully automated as well in Shanghai and a few places like that. But this was the first to get going and be put into service. So there are a couple of examples. What about our sector? We have actually done some good stuff. One thing though to recognise is that our market is dominated by the D&C market and also the PPP market. We've done some really good examples of integrated design and construction and design to fabrication work. And last year I talked about the health innovation building. This is a full fabrication model. There were a couple of things that didn't quite work perfectly, but this model probably saved the project in terms of program and was probably still the benchmark in terms of that design to fabrication workflow. We're also getting going in places, but not consistently in terms of offsite fabrication. But it really doesn't matter how good the offsite fabrication capability is if the onsite execution can't deal with it. I showed this slide 10 years ago, and what this slide shows, just so everyone can remember, is that this was a new hospital. There was no work in the US back in 2010 and 11, and this project team won the project, and the point was that that project team decided that they were going to commit to their means and methods, and their means and methods were to get those cast-in hangers in before the concrete, right? Everyone in the project team is committed to that. I've got a project at the moment, or I haven't personally, but my business has, where we've got 25 or 30,000 casting hangers that are sitting in our warehouse and not in the slab, because we can't get the commitment to commit to the means and methods. And until we can make the investments with confidence in BIM designing for construction and the virtual build, and not get and be confident that we're going to get the commitment to get those improved workflows on site, then we're going to continue to struggle. This is what it looks like in the UK. There is absolutely not one ounce of doubt around how this project's going to get delivered. It's going to be off-site fabricated and assembled on-site. So you cannot drive to this site and not understand that you're part of a system. So this is where our competition are at, and they could be here tomorrow. So the other thing that I wanted to talk about, and some of these are going to probably surprise you a little bit, is the energy grid is a really big thing. And the decarbonisation of energy in this country, as is around the world, is a really big thing. And it's a big thing for a big part of the industry in terms of new builds. We run one of the largest energy grids. Most days, sometimes South Australia gets disconnected, and some months Tasmania gets disconnected, but as a whole, it's one of the largest grids anywhere in the world. And it is having renewable energy connected to it at a remarkable pace. So the wholesale price over summer now, routinely, is $0. That's why the coal-fired power stations are in a lot of trouble, right? And why you're seeing the older assets getting retired, okay? A large part of the grid sits behind the meters. I cannot tell you how important it is to get the BIM platform to support the power train from the motor to the transformers and to have that fully analysed. The design of electrical systems now it's not as complicated as a computer chip, but it's actually getting beyond the point that people can actually design them by hand or do the calculations. Sure, they can get them done, but it's a really, really important thing that we sort this out. So you're going, I don't know about that. Let me just tell you about a few things. So a lot of the property trusts now are looking to actually decarbonise their electrical supplies. So whereas it was considered cheating 5 or 10 years ago to buy green power, today that's considered to be fully valid strategy, because actually people worked out it's a better strategy than putting a small number of panels on the roof or wind turbines. So you won't see any more wind turbines on buildings. What they're going to go and do is buy a wind turbine somewhere in the country. You're starting to see property portfolio owners actually remove gas heating from their buildings. I do quite a bit of work in Tasmania. It's all heat pumps. And there's a number of buildings in Victoria that are looking to convert their gas heating to heat pumps. So there's a big market there, and the big property trusts are very focused on it. This is the most powerful image that I've seen on the subject. It's two words and one image. Think copper. And what you see there is someone charging their electric car, right, in a building. I think it's actually, that might be the Sydney Opera House. But what it will be in the future is commercial office buildings. So people will want to come, park their car, which will be electric, in the office building, and they'll want to charge their car at the cheapest time of day. And we'll probably want to get in the car knowing that the car is fully charged. So that's going to really reshape a lot of the electrical infrastructure within buildings. What you need to know is that a 75 kilowatt hour Tesla uses 3 times the daily average of average household. So the implications for the building power infrastructure and the implications for the grid are huge. This is what AGL thinks of the market. 200 billion required over the next 20 to 30 years, and 70 billion required behind the grid, behind the meter. So it's really important that we have the technology stack to actually do this part of the system really, really well. I don't believe we've got it at the moment, and we need to build it. The other thing, which is a holy cow moment, is the rise of asset management analytics, maintenance and operational analytics. So I don't know quite what totally launched this. I don't know if it was Power BI, but now everyone wants analytics. You cannot win a major maintenance contract in this country now without having a pretty sophisticated offering in this space. So if you haven't got that offering, you're excluded from a large part of the market now. What's happened is, this was an image that I think we presented a year or so ago. And what it talks about is the progress of design in terms of BIM. BIM and digital construction, and we're past that chasm, and digital AM and facility management was just missing in action. This is probably what it looks more like today. Okay, so all of these property owners have suddenly got interested in digital asset management, somewhat interested a little bit in terms of BIM deliverables, but they're moving very, very quickly. And so the world's changed in only 1 to 2 years. Here's the thing though, and this thing's plastered with holy cow moments. So this is an IIoT enabled chiller, and lots of the big manufacturers are bringing IIoT enabled equipment to the market. And what you see there is that what they're interested in pitching for to take over essentially power by the hour, or some high level maintenance service offering, and start connecting a few of those types of systems together, and it can really change the dynamics of the maintenance market. And this is why I think, in some sense, a lot of these major manufacturers, they're more focused on IoT than they are on BIM. Okay? So we need to, this is a holy cow moment by quadrupled. It's something we need to think about collectively. So we need to sort out a practical set of deliverables for asset management, and we need a common data environment that supports asset and maintenance analytics. But what we don't need is bespoke, and we don't need over the top. We just need the bare minimum in a consistent requirement. And what Bob Baird's done with defence is he's narrowed his requirements down to 6 standard sets of requirements. That's quite a lot, but defence covers quite a lot of ground in terms of the nature of their assets. But we're not moving forward as an industry, and we're not capable really, at this point at least, of delivering bespoke maintenance asset sets and the like for every single user. We need a common set for commercial buildings, we need a common set for healthcare facilities and probably data centres, and we need to get a consistent set of requirements that we know how to deliver. I want to talk a little bit about global standards and alignment. So last time I mentioned to you that we were looking at OmniClass and UniClass, and we felt UniClass was the way to go. What we've done in over the journey, so we've really looked at this in a lot more detail, and we absolutely know that UniClass is the way forward for this market. It's much more closely aligned with the products that we need. So things like chilled beam surfaces are all there. It doesn't dive into the depths that OmniClass does in some areas. And it's got much better coverage, and I'll show you a little bit of this moving forward. The other thing that's happening over the last five to 10 years, and it's lucky a little bit that we fluffed around with fire protection for a while, because the new standard's just come out. But basically, Australia's heading down the ISO route. And the only thing that we're likely to end up really in the longer term is a set of standards around that are closely related to the National Construction Code. So things such as the gas code, the electrical code and those, I'm sure will remain Australian, but everything else that goes into them will be ISO based. The only thing that probably varies a little bit is that steel piping is still essentially all US based. Copper's a bizarre one. It's an Australian sort of, I think we share it with Ireland, I think, I'm not quite sure. But pretty much a very defined set of standards around piping, which mostly are not ISO except for some flanges. We've also, just so we're really clear, we're aligned with Building Smart, and IFC exports we recognise as a really important data exchange format. And so I'll talk a little bit about that as well. The top right-hand picture is a map of the world, indicating which are the greeny blue is IEC based electrical design systems, basically based originally on the standards set by AEG in Germany, and the orange is basically the US system, which is quite a different system. We need a technical stack that supports both environments equally well. As I said, we haven't nailed BIM standards. Data here, I think, went back and looked at, tried to understand what was going on and had to get reprogrammed by Geordie. Clearly overwhelmed him, but the fundamental point is standards have to be written in a way that normal people can read them and interpret them. Okay, we're not all data heads. We need to be able to read human readable codes in a way. We need to make sure that the platforms that we got are what I call engineering grade or gold standard, and we need to sort some of those underlying things out. We all love bespoke design. We will be poorer the day bespoke design gets ridden over by some form of standardisation. But once we've got a bespoke design, we need standardised processes. Okay? Bespoke design is great. Bespoke delivery is not so great. And bespoke as-built deliverables is a nightmare. So we're not supporting bespoke design. We're not supporting our architects to do great things. They make the world a very much richer place. But when it gets down to the delivery, it's details that deliver. So that's a bit of a background. So here are the things that we've been working on, and we think that it's going to set us up to address these challenges. And what we're really hoping is that you'll get behind what we're seeking to achieve, and I think that we'll get ourselves to a really, really good place. So today we're launching these four key things, and I'll take you through each of those in a little bit of detail. This is the only chance that we get to really present each year and have the audience's undivided attention. We have been sending out newsletters, but I'm not quite sure how much attention you're paying. But we're pretty excited, and we're hoping to get you engaged. So the first thing that we've done is that we've introduced a structure for disciplines and roles. So these are pretty central to how we package up the modelling works and the workflows through the project. These are the disciplines that we've come up with. And what you'll see is that some of the disciplines are broken up. So fire detection and fire protection, both would have been previously probably sitting under fire services. We did have a problem because that's food services now. So it sort of worked out well. But fire detection as a package tends to run through the industry slightly differently. It'll get documented by the same designers, typically, but once it gets to the trades, it typically gets broken up into two packages. So this handles those sorts of things. You'll see there's a bit of a breakup in terms of structure, how that goes. We've got a fair coverage of of these that we've sort of looked at quite a few BIM execution plans by the majors, and we think this meets a number of needs. We've also defined, and you probably can't read all of that, but we've also probably defined another 40 specialist disciplines that would contribute to the design process or the project management process or lifecycle asset management process. Okay, so that helps in terms of roles and responsibilities. But fundamentally what we're doing that no one else is doing is we're recognising the very simple truth that we organise our life around disciplines. So why go and change everything for BIM, knowing that it's digital? Why don't we get back to the way we organise our work? And so that's what we've done. I know some people are going to go, hang on, Revit's disciplines, different, you're mucking us all up. So basically related to MEP, they're the Revit disciplines. And what we've said is we're just going to define those as Revit MEP disciplines. You and I call things disciplines. It's established practice for the last 90 years. That's the way we organise it. And we've let Autodesk do their thing. And we've just defined those as Revit MEP disciplines. So where we're referring to Revit MEP discipline, we'll specifically call it out as that. We've also introduced a component naming and tagging thing, structure. And what that does is that for the first time really defines a naming convention. So what you tend to find is, and it'll be familiar to you, don't worry, we're not turning your world upside down, but what you tend to find is 80 to 90% of people are using the same sort of thing, and it's the same sort of thing, but not the exact thing. And that starts to create real headaches when you're starting to get into these large portfolio asset management exercises. So in terms of the tags, the first thing that we've gone and done is we've got mechanical, electricals, fires about 90% there. I sort of promised it last week, but it didn't quite happen. And electricals progressing as well. But what we've got to is a final draft, essentially, that we want to workshop with the consultants and contractors. But one of the things is we've reviewed industry practice. We've gone and checked it now against the new ISO standards. We've cross-checked it against Omniclass and Uniclass. We're working with Uniclass to fill in some of their gaps. And we've also identified those things that relate to maintenance scheduling. So what you see here is a lot of people got into the practice of calling everything a boiler, right? But when you get to a boiler, you're getting into a whole different certification regime, maintenance regime and the like. So what we've said is, what you're calling a boiler, if it doesn't get over 90 degrees, then call it a heating hot water unit, right? Most of that breakup would look entirely familiar to you. And we've separated boilers to be high temperature heating hot water boilers, so that's anything that can flash, and steam. So they're the sort of things that we're clarifying, and what we're looking for is the product suppliers to follow that philosophy and to make sure that their products are correctly categorised. And what that's allowed us to do is then to build the VBIS system, which is this new platform for digital asset management that has been supported by the Victorian government. Quite a few people have looked at this. It builds on the people-readable codes that have come out of the component structure here. And a lot of people are looking at this, and I think Carl Agar will be explaining this in a fair bit of detail. But we're pretty confident that it builds a common data environment for lifecycle asset management. When you look at things like chillers, again, we're working with Uniclass, so we've identified those as the main breakups. And we think that most people, when they're doing asset management, would want to know that, yeah, it's not just a chiller, what type of chiller it is, and what type of compressor it's got on it. Because once you've got that, you know what you're sort of looking at. There's a missing one there, which in terms of the UniClass classification, but UniClass have now got that in. Here's the naming convention that we've built, and that will look pretty familiar to you. We've defined some rules, for instance, around the VSDs, so that the VSD is really a subsystem of the component. And you can look at that, and you can also we can also say the supply air fan is a subcomponent of an AHU. Quite a few people have looked at how this works and said, yeah, that's going to really work well from an analytics, data analytics perspective. The other thing, though, is quite interesting, is that there's quite, particularly in the fire area, there's a lot of changes to terminologies with the new code. So an FIP becomes an FDCIE. It's the only Australian standard where I've seen the words under the definitions predicated. And what that means is that I had to go and look it up, but it basically what it means is predacted, one of the two, I think, is basically Australia, we're saying we're not happy, Janet. So they've accepted the change in the code to line up with the ISO, but they still would have preferred to keep their own coding, but they've gone with the aligned naming conventions. What you'll probably see is that the cupboard will still have FIP on it, but the equipment will be coded as FDCIE. So a lot of these things involve a fair bit of headbanging and angst, but we think we've got a pretty good system now. Probably the biggest announcement that we've got, and I will admit, we did plagiarise this off rfa.org a little bit, but we've got a lot further, is that we've developed a single point of truth for shared parameters on the website. And it's open in as much as anyone can go and refer to this website and get a shared parameter name that is structured and works within the system. Not only does it cover the equipment, it covers the lifecycle asset management requirements, the procurement requirements, and the whole sequence. So you'll start to see really structured shared parameter names. Actual is the actual measurement of a design quantity. We've got the units. We've got the what version it is in the template. We've classified the groupings so that you can find stuff. We've got the classification under Revit, and we've got whether it's an instance or not. This is real headbanging stuff, but it when it's done, it provides a really strong platform for the industry to move forward. If you're a subscriber, you get the you get the GUIDs that you need for your BIM models. So besides that, it's fully open and anyone can access it. So it doesn't matter if you're still in Excel land, you can access the shared parameter names. And with each shared parameter, we've got the details fully listed out. I've told Shannon we've got a couple of improvements to make. So one of the, we tell you what what's meant by the thing if there's any need for clarification. When we've got standard values, we've got the value range that you can should be considering. What we're looking to do is to add one small text box to provide some guidance on the selection of those value ranges. We've also reloaded our specifications. And what you'll find is we're providing a schematic block, generic design model, requirements, IFC mapping, functional type classification, the BIM classifications to OmniClass, UniClass, VBIS, all of the connector settings, because there's often a fair bit of angst in all that, and the shared parameters. Now, this is a pretty controversial sort of thing, but product data templates. Some people go completely bonkers with product data templates. We've broken ours down into three, and we might provide a fourth. So what we've done is that we've got a product data template that covers every single shared parameter that could possibly be used with that product, get it designed, procured, commissioned, and handed over. That list is quite long. So what we've done is that we've actually also got what we're calling a component data template, which is typically matching up, possibly with a little bit more detail, what the consultants would normally specify. What we're, and the things that the consultant should be doing. So a consultant should specify where the power for every electrified component using it with a motor should come from. So asking you to nominate that. There's some really good quality checks built into this. And what we're saying is that we want you, you know, how's it we can get a model, right, which is fantastic, but when we get our specification sent through to us, they're all sent through as PDFs. And then what happens is that when we get stuff back from our suppliers, it's all in PDFs, and it's a nightmare to check. I got involved in a chiller procurement, probably not a smart move. But anyway, what we got back was about 60 or 80 pages of stuff that PDF responses, and somehow we had to translate that and work out whether the stuff was complying, not complying, what the relative merits of each of those things were. Had we got an Excel spreadsheet and we were able to issue that, and when the suppliers got it, they said, yeah, we understand this format, and just provided a technical schedule back, that would cut the time involved in assessing tenders probably 60, 70%. So the first thing that I'm asking is for consultants to change the format of the way that they issue their technical schedules. It sounds really basic in a BIM world, but it's a sensible step to get them some pretty significant benefits. From there, we've got a procurement schedule, which has got a lot more detail. And what that typically covers is the information that the contractors have to deal with to actually fully schedule a component to get it brought, manufactured and sent to site. The other big announcement that we've got is electrical fabrication parts. So we've done a lot of work. A2K have put a lot of work into this in recent times to get this done. This is a really significant step forward, because what this allows us to do is then with PowerCAD is to accurately measure cable runs and to start to size cable tray. It's not possible to really do it in Revit families. And what it allows us to do, I think these images are care of Stowe, so thank you, is to actually get this sort of quality modelling, because cable tray gets to like duct and pipe a little bit and gets quite complex in its coordination, particularly around main switch rooms and the like. So this is a pretty exciting step forward and saves these two issues. So often every metre of a large submain is probably hundreds of dollars. And you typically see, particularly in main switch ward rooms, hundreds and hundreds of metres of potentially cable offcuts. The other thing is that people totally underestimate the weight of cable in a cable tray. There's been a number of collapses on sites, and if that came on you, down on you, you'd be, you'd probably be dead. So there's a lot of good things that can come out of getting fabrication parts for electrical cable trays. There's just a couple of observations I'd like to wrap up with, and I think these are really important. So this has been around for quite a while, or since the start, really. We've made a couple of slight changes to this. So here, we've got LID 350-400. So what's happened is that BIM Forum have developed a incredibly detailed guide to LID development for services, well, including services. And they take it to 400, but the LID 350 is a coordinated model in Revit and probably suitable for approvals. But the fabrication model sort of takes it all the way in terms of what a constructor would do. The question a little bit is, does the industry really need a fabrication level detailed model, or does it actually need an LOD 350 model that's been updated? So in a commercial office building, they're probably what's really needed is an LOD 350 native Revit model, because that can go back to the designers and they can then do their tenancy design changes using that model. In terms of where the best standards are, this is probably a couple of years ago now, but this is really the gold standard project that I've seen. And what people think is that they're going to save time in terms of not having to remodel something. But it's all the value that you can add in that time that's been saved to actually really get your construction sequence and your assembly sorted out. From that model, you know, you're able to deliver these sorts of images for the operators. And this is the latest one from Aurora, from, again, Urban Consult. And that's really what constructible Revit modelling looks like by designers. And you could build off that if you wanted to. Virtually, you'd probably have to tidy a few things up, but there's no doubt about how that model's going to, how that building's going to be built, and it's an absolute winner. So the thing, though, as I was saying, there's no connection between here and the motor. So we need to sort out those VSD families. The model, and then some projects now, we're starting to see the model is actually the designer's deliverable, not the drawings. So the drawings, not part of the specified requirement, only on a couple of projects, and I don't know quite how that go, but we'll, that's where things are starting to head. This is a really important point. Not many BIM execution plans lock in a model upgrade at the start of the virtual build. So what we've got in 2019 is that we've still got 2016 models coming through, and we can't access, unless there's an agreed upgrade, we can't access 3 years of development work in design to fabrication. So either the services team need to say that's what we need to get to the latest sort of proven, validated version of Revit, otherwise we're like olive growers. We've made all the investment, but we haven't got the result. Okay, so what I'm suggesting is that at the start of the virtual build, certainly for major projects, that there's an agreement that you're going to lock into the last version of Revit so that we can capture the value of that development work that's been done. The ability to model a building's ISO IEC-based power distribution system from the motor to the transformer is now critical. It is now critical, and it needs to be get done. We put this up before. The fact is, these new motors, and particularly the IEC 5 motors, they actually need a bigger drive to drive them. Just finding that out at the moment. But so understanding the motor and the connection to the drive and the harmonics and the power characteristics is incredibly important. When you look at a plant room, a MEC plant room, there's a very significant part of the electrical load is sitting in that plant room, and we need to be able to model it accurately. The inductance in the cabling in Australia and in IEC-based electrical systems is a really, and the impedance is really, really important. And it's different where it's been conduited and non-conduited. So we need to have an electrical stack of technologies that can model those and optimise the design. Needs to be able to handle main switchboards, needs to be able to go through to the transformers and model those characteristics, particularly in terms of harmonics and power factors. And, you know, there's been some pretty major design issues where the generators haven't been able to force the discrimination to work correctly. The problem with that is that if you're in a hospital, you can't discriminate between essential and non-essential services. So we really need to solve these problems and get them done pretty quickly. The digital supply chain, we're incredibly well served in Australia by companies like Holyoake and Fantech. Probably Fantech, I think, is the global leader in this space in terms of plant, but we're pretty badly let down by the major international global firms, and we need to work out how to get that issue resolved. Finally, we need, as I mentioned, we need to work out what the deliverables are. So this slide here is just work that we've been doing in Rialto, but what that says is that we need a solution for tenancy fit-out management. It's incredibly important that we actually know exactly what VOV terminal is where, because there's a lot of angst associated with not knowing which terminal and how much air it can do and whether it can turn down adequately. So we need to make sure that those as-built records are correct. But we need a naming, a commitment to the naming conventions is absolutely what we need. And until we sort out this, we're just in for a continuing BIM horror story. So what we're asking the designers and all interested stakeholders to do is to come in the next couple of months to a meeting to effectively sign off on those naming conventions. And then we're asking you to go back and to implement them within your business. So I'll just run you through the way these things sort of tend to work.
Do you know your name?
The thing is, I know this meeting is going to hold a fair bit of headbanging and going to be some excitement, but hopefully you'll get on board and then hopefully you'll be excited when you leave and hopefully you'll go and implement these naming conventions within your business. We need real commitment to define the IFMs. I don't think people understand just how complex this job is you know, some of these specifications like the fans and the pumps, which are probably the complex ones, some of those are well north of 50,000, probably getting to 100,000 to develop. Some of the simpler ones are less than that. But the complex ones, it's an incredibly expensive, difficult process to sort out. We love bespoke design, as I think we've mentioned, but we need to drive efficient MEP workflows. And it's probably best if we follow Bob Baird's lead and Jacinda. We just get a simplified set of deliverables. So if we can achieve all of that in the next 1 to 2 years, we'll be in really good shape for 2025. And we hope you'll get on board, and we hope that you'll commit. Thank you.